morning and welcome to worship. Today, we're excited to celebrate Men's Day at Mount Zion. I'd like to give a special welcome and a special thanks to my friend and colleague, the Reverend Rodney Hudson, who is the lead pastor of the Resurrection West Cooperative Parish in the city of Baltimore. This cooperative parish consists of Ames United Methodist Church, Metropolitan United Methodist Church, and St. James United Methodist Church. Reverend Hudson works on the front lines of ministry. You can constantly see him meeting needs in the community, providing spiritual leadership in the community, and being involved in actions that result in social justice. I'd also like to thank Brian Jenkins and Larry Morgan for their leadership for putting Men's Day together, getting the men together, and putting this service together. The service will be absolutely amazing. The worship will be off the chain. The word will be a rhema word for today, and God's name will be glorified. Enjoy.
Good morning, church, and welcome to today's Men's Day celebration. Due to COVID-19, coronavirus, the COVID, or the Rona, whatever you want to call it, we'll not be in the sanctuary today, but we'll be bringing to you a pre-recorded program to celebrate. This year's theme is "This Too Shall Pass," scripture of Romans chapter 5, verses 2 through 5. We hope you enjoyed today's program. As you can see, we have a lot set up for you today. Thank you once again for joining us, and God bless.
God of hope, called to worship. God of hope, we come into your presence this morning with confidence that you will meet us here. Where there is sadness, bring joy. Where there is tiredness, bring refreshment. Where there is despair, bring a renewed sense of hope. Let this place be a sanctuary, a safe haven for us, a home for holy words, songs, and prayers as we devote ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hey, Father God, I want to thank you for waking us up this morning, Father God. Keep us all in prayers as we go through COVID-19. Pray for the loved ones that we've all been missed, Father God, as they couldn't see them as they passed away. Pray for the young black men that are out here getting killed by these police brutality. Pray for the families that's out there that get kids killing one another. Keep us all in prayer, Father God, that we can't see our loved ones out in nursing homes, jails, places where we can't see them as they pass away. Pray for my male course, my men, my ladies, and my course. Keep us all strong. Keep us all faithful. I miss my church. I want us to continue to lift us up in prayer. You know, Father God, without you, we can't do it without you at all. Your name is stronger than the COVID-19. God is stronger than COVID-19. Everyone be prepared. He's coming back. He's going to bless us. He's going to look after us. You're going to continue to take care of us. As I lost my loved ones, my brother-in-law, my cousin, my uncle, my aunt, as we went through this COVID-19, keep my family in prayer also. Father God, we love you. We're going to pray for you. On Men's Day, thank you for another day. Keep us strong. Keep us safe. Bless my church family. Keep their family safe, the Hall family. Continue to bless Jerry Hall and his family and everyone, Father God. We have lost so many great ones as we come go through this COVID-19. I pray, our Father, who art in heaven, thou be our name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us our trespass as we give those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thou is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Father God, just stay with us and continue to guard us and hold us in our arms. Look after the families that's out there in California as the fire continues to burn and burn and burn. Father God, I know you got control of everything that's going on in this world today. The tornadoes, the hurricanes, the floods. Just keep blessing us, Father God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you. What do you see? You see your family members, fathers, grandfathers, uncles, and siblings. I see those that laid the foundation for what we have today. I see those that set a standard, that helped them set goals to become a better person. Yes, there were difficult times on your journey, but you kept focused and walking towards the light of hope. Time is a gift from God, and we typically don't know how much time we have left here on earth. It's this precious gift that we must use wisely. We thank you, gentlemen, for your time, effort, and dedication. We will continue to build on what you started. We have a unique collection of men with various skill sets, willing to do the work that is needed, even tasks that most aren't willing to do. Sometimes, even a simple task can lift a heavy burden from someone. We have those that have served Air Force, Army, Marines, and Navy. The sounds played by our musicians are melodious. And boy, when those men sing, joy is brought to many people. Some people we don't see every Sunday, but know that you're in our prayers. We know that if help is needed, that you will answer the call. We will seek guidance from some, especially from our legacy members. We will do our best to pass our knowledge on to the next generation. To the men of Mount Zion, I just want to simply say thank you.
Church, we have one presentation this year. The recipient is very deserving. He's never complained, and recognition for him is past due, like Kareem getting a statue or Chewbacca getting a medal. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to present to you the Mount Zion Man of the Decade Award to Larry Morgan Jr. Over the past 10 years, Larry has been the president of the youth committee, president of the United Methodist Men, communications director. He's worked with the worship committee. He is a worship leader. He's a singer and a musician. And he does all this while being a husband, father, and mentor. Ladies and gentlemen, the Mount Zion Man of the Decade.
I've had heartaches like this before, and disappointment by the score.
claim the victory at last. This too will pass, the sun will shine. It can't rain all the time, though clouds are gray. It has to pass away, away, away. I've had heartaches like this before, and disappointments by the score. I claim the victory at last. This too will pass. So bear your heartaches, your grief and pain. Whether the sun shine or the rain, just know it cannot last. This too will pass, the sun will shine. It can't rain all the time, though clouds are gray. It has to pass away, away, away. So bear your heartaches, your griefs and your pain. Whether the sun shines in your rain, just know that this cannot last. This too will pass.
Good morning, church. I'll be reading Romans chapter 5, verses 2 through 5 from the New Revised Standard Version. That's Romans chapter 5, verses 2 through 5. And it reads, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of the sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us.
It is with great joy that we do greet you in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, to the Hardwood and Mount Zion United Methodist Church, and to the Reverend Dr. Cynthia Belt, who has invited me to be the guest speaker at this Men's Day celebration. We do honor the Spirit of Christ and thank God for the opportunity to stand before you and to proclaim that Jesus is Lord. And when you know that Jesus is Lord, you don't have a problem with praising him. So we thank, give God the glory, the honor, and the praise for all that God has done. Hallelujah, God, we worship you and we bless your name. Oh, yeah. Oh. Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. what he said. Yes, he has.
He's gonna fulfill
every promise.
Promise to you.
Yeah.
Don't give up on God,
cause
he won't give up on you. He's able.
Put your hands together if you know God is able. If you know God is able. Every promise to you.
He's gonna fulfill.
Yeah.
Every
promise. Yeah. Don't you give up.
Don't give up on God.
And he won't give up.
He won't give up on you. He's able.
If you know he's able, you ought to know God is able. Oh. Up on God, cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God. God won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, cause he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, cause God won't give up on you. Don't you give up on God, he won't give up on you. Don't give up on God, cause God won't, he won't, he won't give up on you. He's able. Beloved, for the time that is mine, I would like to direct your attention to the letter written by Paul to the Romans, Romans chapter number 5, beginning at verse number 3, concluding at verse number 5. Listen to what Paul writes to the church that is at Rome. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus the Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations, also knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts, by which, by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For the time that is mine, I would like to tell this text with a sermonic consideration. Keep hope alive. Keep hope alive. Beloved, one of the most memorable times in my life was the time that I recalled the passing of my mother. It was a most memorable time because throughout her sickness, she had battled with breast cancer. It was that battle with breast cancer that showed me what hope looks like. There were days when she was up, and then there were days when she was down, having to go through chemotherapy and radiation. And for 7 to 8 years, she battled with cancer. And can I tell you that throughout her battles, each time that I would visit and each time that I would call her, she always had a word of encouragement. When all of my hope had seemingly died, it seemed as if deep down inside of her, there was a hope that was still spreading up like a well of water. She was full of hope. When the doctor said that she would not make it past 3 years, she defied the odds. And beloved, I come to tell you that is what hope is. Hope is believing that you still have a chance despite what the odds may say. Hope is living today. And the truth of the matter, when we look at our world, this world is vanquished of hope. All around us, especially in Baltimore City, when you walk the streets, we find people who are walking around hopeless and aimless, without direction and purpose. There's trouble all around us. Just look at the state of our school system. Look at the state of our government. Many of us are feeling hopeless. But today our text teaches us that we can keep hope alive. And beloved, it's hard to keep hope alive when it just seems like it's dark outside and the daylight will never come. But I'm so glad that the Bible says that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And that's good news when it seems like it's a perpetual midnight, that we know that just before the daybreak, that there is a new day that is coming. Do you realize that it's a new day coming in your life, despite what it may look like, despite what it may seem like, that morning time is on its way? And if you believe that, then you've got to keep a semblance of hope. You've got to keep hope alive. And right now, when we talk about life, we're talking about the ability to breathe and to exist. You've got to understand that hope exists right now. Hope exists in your family. Hope exists in our schools. Hope exists. I come to tell you that fear will cause us to doubt whether or not hope is alive. And here in this text, in this 5th chapter of Romans, Paul is writing to the Roman church. We are not quite sure of who originated this church. There are a variety of ideas of how it came into existence. But the main point is that this church in Rome was a living and alive church. This is just before the persecution initiated by Nero, and the Romans are thriving. It is a time of peace. This Roman church was written by Paul. Perhaps he was said to have been in Corinth when he wrote this epistle. And he is writing to a largely Jewish population that is within the church, coupled by some Gentiles. And as you know, the Jews believed in this idea of sacrifice and atonement. And so this text, this letter of Romans talks about atonement and sacrifice. It talks about what it really takes to be a part of God's body. It tells us what it takes when it seems as if all hope is gone. For you know, the Old Testament was hardly largely believed by the Jewish population. And the Old Testament did not offer hope, but it offered consequences. But here in this text, Paul offers some hope. And let me tell you, he lets us know a few ways of how we know that hope is alive. The first way we know that hope is alive is when we are going through our pain. Yeah, hope is alive Hope is alive. Hope is displayed. Hope is seen through our pain. And the fact that we can experience pain gives us hope that there is a bright side somewhere. Look at what Paul says in the first verse. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we also have access by faith into his grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory, check this out, in tribulations, also knowing that tribulations worketh patience. That's good news. The good news that Paul is telling these Christians is that you don't have to be fearful. You don't have to be afraid, because of what the old law brought to us was damnation and consequence. But the good news is that when you go through your trouble, the law could not take the pain away. When you were going through your trouble, the law could not soothe your heart. But when Jesus Christ came and abolished the law, he gave us a reason to keep hope alive. And so even the fact that we're able to experience tribulations and sufferings is an idea, is an acknowledgement that we're still alive. Look at your neighbor and shout out, I'm still alive. The fact that you're able to experience pain, the fact that you're able to see, the fact that you're able to inhale and exhale points to the fact that you're still alive. And one of the first things I want to say about being alive is that whenever you go to the triage, the first thing that the triage nurse does is take your pulse. And if you don't have a pulse, they consider that something must be wrong, that you must be dying. But I got good news for the church today. The fact that you still can shout out that you go through some pain, some hell, chaos, and confusion is an indication that you still have a pulse. Look at your neighbor and shout out, I still have a pulse. I know they have counted you out. I know they said that you would never make it. But the fact of the matter is that you're still here. You're still inhaling and exhaling. And that's what Paul is trying to tell the church, that you ought to be glory. You ought to have glory in the midst of your tribulation, because it could have been the other way. You ought to give God glory when you go through your troubles and your pain, because it's an indication that God still has room to work. And so you know that hope is alive when you go through pain. I thank God for the pain that I had to go through, because when the pain is there, I know that I can still fall on my knees and pray to God and ask him to take the pain away. And so we know that hope is alive when we are able to encounter pain. And right now our world is encountering pain. Our world is in pain right now with this epidemic and with this virus pandemic. We are going through some pain, but don't act like God is not still God. The same God that was with your mama, the same God was with your father, is the same God that's going to see you through. God is alive in your pain. But not only that, the text lets us know. Look at what Paul says. Paul says it right here, that we ought to glory in our tribulation, knowing that tribulation worketh patience. And then the second thing you ought to know, the reason why I know that hope is alive, is because I can still push. Look at your neighbor and shout out, I can still push. Look at what the text says. The text says, and patience, check this out, patience, experience, and experience hope. This word experience suggests to me that endurance, this word experience suggests to me the ability to continue to go through despite what the odds may say. This word experience suggests, is a connotation for the word persistence. And I come to tell you that you know you are alive when you can continue to push despite everything that has happened. And somebody said that push is an acronym for pray until something happens. I don't know who I'm talking to, but as long as I can push, as long as I can persevere, as long as I can pray, I know that hope is still alive. and these Christians had to push, they had to pray, they had to persevere. And although this is a time of peace, you've got to understand that before there is a storm, there is a calm. God was preparing this Roman church for what was to come. And so Paul is telling them, yeah, I know you leaned on the sacrifice. I know you leaned on what the Old Testament said. But when Jesus Christ died on the cross, you're not justified by the works that you've done. You're not justified by your money or your education, but you're justified by faith. And since you have this faith in you, you can keep hope alive. And the text says that it's in your persistence, that your experience, that hope is born. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I come to tell somebody that everything, every experience, every tribulation, everything that you have gone through in your life prepared you for your now. Every situation. In fact, there are some folk who discounted you and said that you would never make it. They prepared you for your now. Your past is just a resume of what God can do. Is there anybody here who don't mind saying that you made it this far because of God, not because of your college education, not because of your money, not because of who your mama was or your daddy, but it was because of the capital G-O-D. And I'm glad today that I have the experience. And the experience don't come simply because I'm good, but the experience came because I was persistent. I kept on fighting. I'll never forget when I went into the army. I jumped out of airplanes and I was going through airborne school. I almost quit. I almost gave up on the army, but I thank God that God had given me persistence to keep on fighting despite the odds. I wanted to get the airborne jump wings, but you couldn't get the airborne jump wings until you did 5 jumps out of the plane, and I had to fight for it. I had to struggle for it. There were times when I cried, but I kept on running. I kept on training. And I come by to tell somebody, just like Paul is telling this church of Corinth, the fact that you're still here, the fact that you're still on the battlefield for the Lord, one of these mornings, and it won't be long, God is going to give you your wings. Keep hope alive. But not only do I know that hope is alive because I'm able to push, but I know that hope is alive, check this out, because of God's presence. The text says it right here, that patience worketh experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit and by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. I'm glad. For scarcely will a righteous man die, yet in peradventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God, check this out, commended his love towards us. But while we were yet sinners, Christ died. That's good news right there. Because he came down through his son, Jesus. And his presence was there. Look at your neighbor and shout out, he was there all the time. I know that hope is alive because God came down through 42 long generations through his son, Jesus. God is with us. The text says that when we were yet sinners, Paul tells them, when you were just running around serving idol gods, when you were around thinking that you were the dogs bow wow and the cats meow because of your position and your pedigree, because of who you thought you were, Christ had already died. That's good news for somebody who wants to condemn themselves and count themselves out. I come to tell you that he already paid the price. When we were yet sinners, when we did not know God, when we did not serve God, he died for you and me. And so we know hope is alive because we experience pain. We know hope is alive because we're able to push. We know hope is alive because we encounter His presence. But the last thing I want you to know is hope is alive because we have proof. The text says it right here. That in verse number 5, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for the righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commended His love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The proof is in. My mother used to say, the proof is in the pudding. The proof is that He died for you and me. And you might be saying, Reverend, how do you know He died for you and me? And the reason why I know that He died for you and me, here is the proof, because it's in the Word of God. Yeah, the proof is in the Word of God. The Bible says the proof is St. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. The proof is in the Word of God. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. The proof is in the Word of God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And the reason why I know that the proof is in the Word, because I see that His Word is true. And when you realize that His Word is true, you stand on the Word of God. And I don't know what word you stand on. There are some folk who will tell us some things and it will never come to pass. But I come to tell you that when you stand on the Word of God, the text says that He commended His love toward us, that when we were sinners, Christ died for us. That's good news. That's the proof that He loved us so much until He died. And I got proof. I look at my own life and see where God has brought me from to where He's brought me to. And I can tell you that the Lord has been good to me. I don't know what your proof is, but come on here, Job, and tell them your proof. Job, you tell them that I was sick, so long flesh fell from his bone. He lost his wife, his cattle, and children. He was told to curse God and die. I come to tell you that you've got to have proof in the Word of God. Job had lost everything, but he got double for his trouble. He got more cattle. He got more children. I come to tell you that when you know God has been good to you, you don't sit down when troubles are going on. You don't give up and throw in the towel, but you got proof. He was with your mama. He was with your daddy. Is there anybody here who don't mind saying, I got proof that the Lord will make a way somehow? Is there anybody here who ever had a bill that you did not know how you were going to pay, but God showed up? The text says that when we were yet sinners, when we didn't understand how God was going to move, God proved Himself to us. He proved Himself to us that He sent His Son to die on the living God. The proof is in the world. Who am I talking to today? I'm talking to somebody who feel like giving up. I come to tell you, you can't give up now. You can't give up now, because you still feel the pain. Hope is in love. You can't give up now. Who can't give up now? Because you keep on pushing. You can't give up now. Because God is with you. His presence is with you. You can't give up now. Because the proof is in His Word. I got proof. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Here comes a hell around my head, the shackles of damnation around my feet. But I heard Jesus saying, look at your neighbor and shout out, neighbor, yeah, God is good, he's good, he's good, he's good, he's good. I want to tell y'all, as I take my seat, I told you my mother battled with breast cancer, and there were times when she was in pain. Good God Almighty. There were times when she felt like giving up. Oh God Almighty. But I believe in my heart that she understood that weeping may endure for a night. Deep down inside, she had the proof. Deep down inside, even though she was going through her pain, she had peace that surpassed all understanding. And that's what verse 1 means. When we're justified by our faith, we have peace with God. And she was ready to meet her God. And I remember the day she died, when I got the phone call, my heart was at peace. And I was at peace because I understood that everything she taught me was real. And today, before you leave this place, men, do you have peace that God is able? Do you have peace that God is able? Do you have peace that he will make a way? Do you have peace? Won't he do it? Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor, won't he do it? Yeah. I'm glad. I'm done. I'm going to take my seat. But before I take my seat, I want to encourage you to get to know this Jesus. They marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall. They beat him all night long. But somebody said he was like a Timex. He took a licking, but he kept on ticking. Good God Almighty. They put a crown of thorns around his head, but he never said a mumbling word. Good God Almighty. They hung him high. They stretched him wide. Put nails in his hand and nails in his feet. They pierced him in the side. But he never said a mumbling word. They took him off the cross, put him in a barrel tomb. He stayed there all day Friday. Good God Almighty. He stayed there all night Friday. He stayed there all night Saturday. Early Sunday morning. Is there anybody here who's glad for Sunday morning? Yeah, I'm through. Maybe you're out there and you don't know who Jesus is. I come to tell you, there's a good time to meet him right now. Come just as you are without one plea. God is waiting for you right now to give your life to him. Maybe you're like the people in this text, like these Romans were. They had no idea they were Jewish and Gentiles in one church. They at peace right now, but they had to prepare themselves for what was coming. And I come to tell you, that you can have that peace right now if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. You can have peace with God, for we're justified by our faith. We're justified by our faith. We're justified by our faith. So this is not the time to give up, but keep hope alive. This is not the time to give up, but keep hope alive.
Good afternoon, everyone. Amen. It's good to be up in the house of the Lord one more time. Amen. Amen. And for blessing us with a beautiful day, waking us up this morning. I know Jesus cares.
joining us today at our Men's Day service, and we hope and pray that you got a message from the Word, and may the peace of the Lord be with you. Let us pray. The love of God be the passion in your heart. The joy of God, the strength when times are hard. The presence of God's peace that overflows. The Word of God, the seed that you might sow. In Jesus' name, amen.